Hi, everyone. Nice to have you with us. And with it being Navy Week in Cleveland, we are so pleased to have a special guest this morning. We have the Undersecretary of the Navy, Thomas Modley, with us this morning. And it's welcome back to home.
Oh, thanks so much for having me.
How are you?
Pleasure. It's fantastic. It's really great to be back in Cleveland, always. But especially for me this time, representing the Navy and being a part of Navy Week, it's a big thrill for me.
Representing the Navy, when I hear that, it sounds like, well, I may not get home very often. Do you get back to Cleveland?
Well, I try to get back. Several friends of mine, we get together once a year for a Browns game, so we try to come back. But it's tough with this job to get much time off. So
yeah, tell me about Navy Week and really the point of this week.
Sure. So the point of Navy Week is to get out to various communities in the United States and expose them to the Navy and what the Navy does. It's an opportunity for us to connect with the population so they understand better what the role and the mission of the Navy is and how we're out there every day defending freedom all over the world. And also to try and recruit people, to gather some interest from young people to join the Navy. This is a great area with a lot of intellectual capital, and we'd like to be able to bring those people into service and give them some exposure to what we do.
I imagine when it comes to recruiting, it is so helpful when you can talk face-to-face with someone versus, you know, the other ways of doing it.
Oh, absolutely. And last night I was at an event at Luke Easter Park. A lot of young kids there, and I challenged them to go around the room and talk to as many Navy people as they could, ask them what they do, and the kids all went around and talked to the Navy folks, and I told them if they wrote me a letter and told me what they learned about the Navy from a sailor, that I would send them one of my coins.
So
as I was leaving, they tracked me down and said, "We need your address, because all the kids are going to have letters to send you soon." So that's really what this is about, really exposing the general population to what we do in the United States Navy.
When you talk about, what do they tell you when they're interested in the Navy? Is it still the patriotism? I want to be there for my country?
Well, there's lots of different motivations that bring people into service. And I think that for me, growing up here in Cleveland, it was about the opportunity to go do something different, something unique, see the world. So it's a lot. It really depends on the individual. But the Navy has a lot to offer to young people. From training and education, but also the opportunity to expose themselves to other parts of the world and other parts of the country, because the Navy brings together people from all parts of the United States, and so you get great exposure to what the country is really about, and I think that's one of the greatest benefits of service.
And that's a great idea here, because so much of our country is landlocked that maybe not thinking about the Navy, but when you have events like this, you do bring in people from all over.
Yeah, absolutely.
Has Cleveland changed a lot for you?
It has changed. Well, it's substantially different than it was in the 70s when I grew up here, but all in much positive, very positive way. I mean, it's just a fantastic city, and I love coming back here to visit. And my kids grew up in the Annapolis area, but they love coming back here as well. So we always have a good time when we come back to Cleveland.
Yeah. Some of the issues, let's talk defense spending. I saw part of your nomination process, and the nickname came out Budget Hawk. You said you wanted to kind of keep costs under control, but are you still getting what you need to protect us worldwide?
Yeah, it's interesting. That's an interesting moniker. I'm not sure where that came from, but really my responsibility in the Navy is I'm the Chief Management Officer of the Navy and the CIO. And my responsibility is really to make sure that every dollar that we get from the taxpayers is used appropriately and that we're getting the most that we can from the money that we get from the taxpayers. That's not the same as saying that I want to limit our budget, because in fact, as we look at the security environment in the world and how complex it's become, that we really need to invest more in defense. We need to build a bigger Navy, and we're on the path to doing that. And that requires the Congress and the American people through their Congress to step up and provide us with those funds. But it's our responsibility to make sure we're spending that money properly. We're not wasting taxpayer dollars. Mm-hmm. And we're really focusing those funds on the right things.
When you say build a stronger, bigger Navy, is that personnel? Is that ships? Is that both?
Well, everything from the Navy, we're very platform-based because we're based on the number of ships that we have. But in order to have ships, you have to have people to man them. You have to have resources to fuel them. So it all sort of is derivative of the size of the Navy that we have. Mm-hmm. Right now, we have about 285 ships. We're trying to build to over 350. That's the goal right now to get there. But from my perspective, as we look at that long-term goal, it's going to be a mix of a lot of different things, not just the traditional ships that we have today, but unmanned platforms and other things, because the technology is enabling us to have a lot more presence and a lot more distributed lethality. So that's really the focus of what we're looking at right now in the Navy.
One of the new terms we're hearing from your commander-in-chief is space defense. Mm-hmm. Your thoughts on that, and then the Navy's role as we go forward?
Sure. Well, space has become just another domain that we need to protect. We have lots of very, very expensive and critical assets in space. And our adversaries are have been very aggressive in figuring out how to combat that capability. So we need to be just as aggressive to make sure that we can protect that. And the president has made it very clear that he wants us in the Department of Defense to determine a way to build a space force so we can basically protect those assets. And so we're in the process of going through and looking at that right now to understand what that means, how we structure the organization to accomplish those objectives. And as a representative, I'm the senior representative of the Navy on those discussions mm-hmm. right now. And the Navy has key interests in that area, even though we're on the water, but clearly right. we need satellites for communication and as do all the other services.
Well, your background is financial, so yes. they got the right guy for the job here. But do you have the concern then if we add another arm to our armed forces, mm-hmm. the pie is only so big. Mm-hmm. You could have a sixth one now. Is there concern there?
Well, of course, there's always concern about that. But there are, it's although we're looking at it now, it's not as if we're not doing things in space right now. So the Air Force is doing things in space. The Navy's mm-hmm. doing things in space. The Army's doing things in space. The question is, how are we organized to do that? So my suspicion is we may not have to make a bigger pie. We'll just have to cut it up differently and align resources so that we have more focus in that area.
Okay. I know you go and you meet a lot of sailors mm-hmm. that are stationed around the world. What do they tell you about today's Navy?
Well, that's the greatest part of this job is when I get out of Washington and I get to go onto ships and talk to our sailors. And I will say that, and my staff is getting very tired of me doing this, but every time I go to a ship, my first question is, anyone from Cleveland? Any Browns fans here? And that's always a really great connection. I think the folks that have grown up here in Cleveland, and it's amazing to know how many people from Cleveland are all over the world, particularly serving in the Navy. I've met them in Sigonella. I've met them in the UK, I've met them all over the world. So they're different sailors than when I was in. I was in the Navy from 1979 to 1990, different era. The kids we have in the Navy now are more educated, much more digitally focused, and so we're trying to build a force that will attract those types of people. But at the core, they're the same. They love the country, they yep. love the Navy, and they really want to serve, and they love serving. So it's really awesome experience for me. And when I get out there, I meet with sailors. I also go, the Department of the Navy also has the Marine Corps under it, so I get out and visit with the Marines. It's amazing what we ask them to do, and they're very, very young. So to me, it's always it's very gratifying to have the opportunity to spend time with them.
You patrol the waters around the world. One of the issues out there has been North Korea. Mm-hmm. Over the last 6 months, from your point of view, where have things gone?
Well, I think the president's approach with respect to engagement is the right approach. I think we've tried, you know, for 20 years, different administrations have been trying to get this thing under control. And I think we're making progress, but I think we have to be very sober in our assessment of this because it is going to take a long time. It's a very close society. It's very sort of unipolar with respect to the power structure there. So I think it's just going to take time. And I think the president and I think Secretary Pompeo is they're both doing everything we can to sort of defuse that situation and get it back onto a more even keel.
Better, but still a lot of work to do.
Yes, and I think that's going to be for a while.
And there's a trust factor there, too, that seems to be better, but we're not there yet either.
Right, and we this is another thing. We can't do this alone. We need the Chinese to help us as well. They're the big yep. power in that region. They have a lot of influence over the North Koreans, and so we really need their collaboration in this.
How, from the Navy's point of view, is the relationship with China and Russia and the other superpowers?
Well, I think it's changing, and I think it's been changing. We've been engaged in war for 17 years in the Middle East, fighting asymmetric threats. And while that's been going on, those two large adversaries have really started to rebuild their militaries. So we're in an era of big, great power competition again. It's different than the one that I came into the Navy in, mm-hmm. where we were basically facing the Soviet threat that was very advanced and capable. Both the Russians and the Chinese are threats to us in different ways. The Chinese are sort of an ascending power. They are investing heavily in their navy, specifically surface navy, as well as their missile defenses and their offensive missile capabilities, which are pose a big threat to us. And the Russians have invested heavily in their undersea capabilities, and so we've just stood up the Second Fleet again to take responsibility for the North Atlantic area, where we suspect that's where a lot of their submarine activity will be focused. So it's different. The way I like to describe it is we've been very used to sort of looking at threats in a unitary way. So during my time, we looked at the Soviet Union, so everything was focused on that great power, right, and we built against that. Then we sort of shifted over to more asymmetric. The future, I think, is going to require us to look at that broad range of threats. And what that requires from us is a Navy and a Defense Department generally is more of a flexible and agile type of force. So agility has to be built into the platforms that we have,
sure,
but also into the people. We have to be able to have people in the service who are very, very comfortable with understanding that the most predictable thing they can expect is an unpredictable situation. And so that requires an agile mind, people who can think quickly, and that's part of one of the things that I'm emphasizing in my job as the undersecretary.
You have to prepare for everything.
Exactly right.
You mentioned more ships.
Mm-hmm.
Well, maybe Cleveland here?
Well,
we've got some news possibly?
Well, there, I will say that my boss, the Secretary of the Navy, and I have been talking about the ship naming process, and I've been lobbying heavily for him to name one of the future ships the USS Cleveland. There have been three ships named the USS Cleveland. The last one was an LPD that was taken out of commission several years ago. There was also a cruiser that saw a lot of battle in World War II. And I'm pushing on him. I said, sir, you know, I think Cleveland would be a great name for a ship. And he actually spent some time here in the Cleveland area.
Okay.
So he's all in on this. Unfortunately, we can't name, or he can't name, until we actually have one of the future ships under contract, which will be probably happening in the next year or so.
Okay.
So I wouldn't be surprised that one of the future LCSs, possibly one that's being built up in Wisconsin, could be named the USS Cleveland, and it would make its transit into the fleet by coming through Lake Erie, and I think that'd be a great a great way to celebrate this town and all its contributions to our defense.
I was going
to
say a tribute to the men and women who have been a part of the Navy for so many years from right here.
Absolutely. Not just the people who have been in the Navy, but
right,
when you read about what the city of Cleveland and the industrial base contributed in World War II, it's really a remarkable story. And so I think it would be a great honor to the city. And so I'm going to keep pushing for it as long as I'm in this job.
We're right here with you.
Great.
You mentioned the Browns a couple of times.
Yes, of course.
Do you have hope?
We all have. Isn't that what being a Browns fan is all about? Absolutely. Yeah, sure. Of course I have hope. I mean, there's a kinship among Browns fans everywhere. That's another thing. I've been to Browns backers clubs all over the world too.
Right.
And it's really a great. There's a big one in Annapolis, actually, in my hometown, and my current hometown.
Mm-hmm.
And so yeah, it's we always have hope. I love all the sports teams here, I have four children. They were all raised in the Annapolis area, but they were forbidden from rooting for any team from Washington or Baltimore. They're all Cleveland fans, and I think it just runs deep for the people that grew up here, and it's one of the great connections that I can make with the sailors when I see them out on the fleet.
I'm guess you closely watch that defense. You're a defensive guy, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. Well, hey, it all starts there. So
you're right.
Yep.
All right, final question. You're the big sports fan. Can you get us LeBron back? Come on, you're way up there in the Navy.
Loved having LeBron here. He contributed amazing things to the city and continues to do so. So I've always been a big fan of his. But, you know, people make decisions, and, you know, there's free agency, and I guess ultimately we're all free agents. And
right.
I have a sense that he's still has his heart here in a lot of ways, so I wish him the best of luck, but I'll continue to root for the Caps.
All right. Well, we're glad you keep coming back as well, Mr. Secretary.
Okay.
It's so nice to meet you.
Thanks for having me.
And have a great Navy week.
Thanks very
much. Thank you for getting the word out, and we really appreciate all you do, your service for our freedom as
well. Thank you. Thank you very much, and thanks for having me.
You bet.